Welcome back to Executive Class. We continue our journey back to the coast and say goodbye to the beautiful hill towns of Val di Noto, which is always hard to do after seeing the finest works of Sicilian Baroque and discovering the area's many hidden treasures. Indeed, it's only recently that towns like Ragusa, Modica, and Noto, especially Noto, with its lovely honey-colored streetscape, have become popular with travelers. So visit now if you can before this once-forgotten pocket of Sicily is overrun by tourists. Indeed, after a visit to the Val di Noto, it's hard to imagine if Sicily can offer any more surprises. But as I'm about to find out, she can. So buckle up as we head back to the Mediterranean coast to the great ancient port city of Syracuse. If Syracuse rings a bell, that's perhaps because you've encountered the name before in history books. Syracuse was one of the ancient world's most powerful city-states, surpassing Athens even in size and glory. Cicero even called it the greatest Greek city and the most beautiful of all. Of course, much of what Cicero described in his day is in ruins today, like the ancient Greek theater where the great Greek tragedies and civic assemblies of the age were staged. Most of the ancient city remains buried underneath, and if you want a better picture of the glorious civilization that stood here, Trafalgar includes a guided tour with a local specialist and a visit to the massive collection of artifacts at the Regional Archaeological Museum.
Most of the other cities in Sicily, you'll be fine with just a guidebook or even Wikipedia. But once you get to Syracuse, because it's so rich in its history, especially the ancient Greek part of its history, you'll really want to go to a museum like this, especially since it's a world-class museum.
The museum houses one of the world's largest and most important collections of ancient Greek artifacts, most of it unearthed in Syracuse and other coastal cities of Sicily that were once part of Magna Graecia, the name for the great Greek colonies that lie in southern Italy. You can skip the nerdy details about classical art if you're not into that, but anyone who walks through these halls will at least discover one important fact, that this part of Sicily was once a great world power with a highly sophisticated culture. Note that Syracuse was also colonized by Romans, Byzantine Christians, Arab Muslims, Norman and Spanish kingdoms, who all influenced the local culture. And though the museum doesn't cover most of these periods in its collection, the city outside the museum's walls do, especially the streets of Ortigia, the historic heart of Syracuse.
Now, just to be clear, because it's confusing to many, when you say Syracuse, there are actually two Syracuse, so to speak. One is a new town, which is where we came from with the museum, and the other is across this bridge, the old Syracuse. Of course, now people call it Ortigia, because it's an island. Ortigia is an island separated by a bridge. And that's where we're going.
The island of the Gulf of Syracuse on the Ionian Sea is compact enough to explore entirely on foot. And walking is the best way to discover the many street-side attractions and archaeological treasures you encounter every step of the way.
Now, most walking tours of Syracuse, let me correct myself, Ortigia, the island of Ortigia, begins here at this square. It's also known as the place where the ancient Greek temple of Apollo stands. Or at least used to stand. So did a Christian church, an Islamic mosque, a Spanish barracks, and then again, back to its original, the Temple of Apollo.
The ruins of an ancient Greek temple to Apollo is a popular attraction, but more so the lively atmosphere of the square, where locals and tourists alike sit at the cafes to watch the colorful life pass by. The square is also a few steps away from the vibrant street market, where fresh produce from the countryside and seafood from the coast are unloaded every day. The colors of the fruits and vegetables are just amazing, and the scent of Syracuse lemons is sweet and enchanting. No wonder Syracuse is famous for its restaurant scene, With ingredients he's fresh, chefs don't have to try too hard to impress. So pick any restaurant in the market and you won't go wrong. Or if you prefer lunch with a view of the sea, head towards the waterfront for an outdoor table overlooking the historic harbor.
This perfect bay over here was the reason why Siracusa was such an important city on the Mediterranean. But it was also what made it so vulnerable.
The wealthy city was constantly under threat from invaders, and those who conquered it left their mark on the city. Walk along its narrow side streets and you'll know what I mean. A rich mix of architectural features. Medieval, Baroque, neoclassical, even fascist. You'll find it all here.
It just never ends. There's always something lovely around the corner.
Better even, head to the main square, the Piazza del Duomo, to see these many layers of cultures combined in a single structure.
That's another beautiful Baroque facade, but it's new. Well, relatively new compared to the rest of the cathedral. You see, by now you must be tired of all the Baroque masterpieces we've been showing you here in Sicily. But this Duomo, this cathedral, is entirely different. It represents 2,500 years of continuous worship from ancient Greek pagans to the Roman pagans, the Byzantine Christians, to the Normans, the Arabs, and of course, today's Sicilians. Now, if you move away from the Baroque facade, which somehow everyone focuses on, and move to this side of the cathedral, you'll see an even more interesting picture emerge. You'll see these pillars representing the ancient pagan temple to Athena. You'll see this Norman wall, a Byzantine tower. That's right. This is the only church in the world that was built and continues to exist on top of an ancient Greek temple.
The Cathedral of Syracuse is a UNESCO World Heritage Site for this reason, but it's also a beautiful Baroque structure, built, like most of the region, after a massive earthquake struck the area. A visit inside reveals these same layers of history, columns of the pagan Temple of Athena most prominently, and the arches built by the Normans. The large square where the cathedral stands is just as impressive. It's one of the most beautiful Baroque squares in Sicily, if not in Italy.
The Piazza Duomo, by the way, is on the highest point of the town of Ortigia. And traditionally, this meant that this is where you had all the wealthy families build their mansions or their palazzo. Today, you still see these aristocratic villas here. And of course, the Duomo. Even the restaurants are a little pricier than the rest of the town.
The espresso is good, and so is the food. But of course it is. This is Sicily, where ingredients do the heavy lifting. But also great is the view of the square, with its honey-colored buildings glowing in the warm Sicilian sun. Naturally, the days get really warm here, which is why the town is full of gelaterias to help cool you down.
Another thing that Siracusa and Ortigia is famous for, apart from the architecture, of course, are their lemons. Really famous lemons. You can enjoy it either as a gelato, as a limonada, a lemonade, or as a granita. It's one of those must-sees, must-dos, must-tries in Sicily.
There are more scenic ways to cool off, like catching the breeze along the waterfront, or sitting around a nearby fountain.
So this is one of the other popular piazzas in Ortigia. It's Piazza Archimede. It's named after the town's most famous citizen, Archimedes.
Indeed, the pumps that are used to draw water in fountains owe their origins in part to one of Archimedes' inventions, the water screw. Yes, the most famous native of Syracuse must have been inspired by all this water surrounding his town. The Archimedes principle, or the mechanical concept of buoyancy, was his other famous discovery. Water, after all, and the location on the mouth of the Ionian Sea were and still are Syracuse's most important resource. and Ortigia's most spectacular feature.
Not a lot of people make it this far to the tip of Ortigia Island, but if you have a few hours to spare, it's definitely worth it. Just look at this. This is the Castello Magnace, a medieval fortress that was built to protect Ortigia's harbor.
Named after the fort established by the Byzantine commander who retook Syracuse from the Arabs in the 11th century, the citadel built by King Frederick of Sicily is now a popular spot for picnics or the favorite southern Italian habit called riposo, the afternoon nap. But I'll forego a nap for now and enjoy another local late afternoon custom, a passeggiata, long and leisurely stroll Sicilians take at the end of each day.
Now here's a tip. If you really want to see Ortigia, you have to get lost in its streets because you'll never find these little pockets of beauty unless you just get lost and find yourself in a place like this.
Just walk around aimlessly in one of Italy's most charming cities in itself. It's not aimless at all. In fact, it's one of the best reasons to visit Syracuse and Sicily in general. The pace of life moves much slower than usual, which is just perfect for travelers like me who enjoy a holiday here like a local. In the next and final part of my Trafalgar Sicilian adventure, I head up the Ionian seacoast to enjoy the Baroque splendors of Catania in the shadow of Mount Etna, before ending the journey in the glamorous seaside town of Taormina.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Saldran in Sicily. Thanks for watching.